यस प्लीज, हरे कृष्णा।
सो हरे कृष्णा, गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू। थैंक यू फॉर बीइंग हियर। सो टुडे द कथा सेशन इज अबाउट राजापुर जगन्नाथ। सो मेनी ऑफ यू मे हैव हैड दर्शन ऑफ राजापुर जगन्नाथ एंड सम ऑफ यू मे नॉट हैव हैड। सो आई टेक दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू थैंक सुकेति माताजी फॉर गिविंग मी दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू ग्लोरिफाई राजापुर जगन्नाथ, बलदेव and Shri Subhadra. They are very, very active and interactive deities. So before I begin, I'll just start with my prayers. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Vyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavamscha श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगान रघुनाथान्वितं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजन सहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधा कृष्णपादान् सह गणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितंश्च हे कृष्णा करुणा सिन्धु दीनबन्धु जगत्पते गोपेशा गोपिका कांता राधाकांता नमोस्तुते तप्तकाञ्चन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी ऋषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये जयत्यं सुरतौ पंगोर्ममा मन्दामतेर्गति मत्सर्वस्वपदाम्बोजौ राधामदनमोहन वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्रीकृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवास आदि गौरभक्तवृन्द हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। नमो विष्णुपदाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनि नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणि प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादि पाश्चात्यदेशकारिणि श्रीमते जयप्रतापस्वामिनि नामिने नमाचार्य पदानि मुखं करोति वाचालं पङ्क्तिं लङ्घयते किरं यत्र पातलहं वन्दे श्रीगुरुं दिनतारिणं परमानन्दमाधवं श्रीचैतन्य ईश्वरं हरि ओं तत्सत्। Okay, so I'm going off video. So here we are today going to discuss the glories of this beautiful-eyed, smiling-faced Sri Jagannath and his elder brother Balaram and his younger sister Subhadra Devi. So we are talking about Jagannath, Baldev and Subhadra, who are situated in the dham of Sri Mayapur. So this Mayapur Dham, the Navadvip Dham, has so many glories, and Bhaktivinoda Thakur describes that the Navadvip Dham is non-different from Sri Vrindavan Dham. Not only is it non-different from Sri Vrindavan, but this Navadvip Dham has all the kshetras in it. Whatever kshetras are there in the world is all fully, entirely situated in the Navadvip Dham. So there is no place as superior as Navadvip Dham. In fact, Navadvip Dham is considered to be even more superior than Vrindavan, because Vrindavan is existing from the spiritual world, but Navadvip Dham is made personally by Srimati Radharani. To attract Krishna back to her, Srimati Radharani made a place even more exquisite than Vrindavan. She made a place even more attractive than Vrindavan, and that place is this Navadvip Dham. So in this Navadvip Dham, as I was mentioning, all the kshetras are present, and Jagannath Puri Kshetra is also very much present in Navadvip Dham, in one of the 9 islands of Navadvip, and the island is called as Simantadvip. The Simantadvip is basically taken care of by Simantini Devi, who is otherwise Parvati Devi. So in Simantadvip, very happily situated, are these most magnificent, gigantic, beautiful, merciful deities of Sri Sri Rajapur Jagannath, Baladev and Subhadra Mai. So I just like to read a little glorification of the Dham before I go in. Just one second. Okay, I'm not able to find that section anyway. So let's understand first, most of you may know the actual story of how Jagannath, Baladev, Subhadra, this form of Sri Krishna, how he came to existence. So we understand that Lord Jagannath is non-different from Krishna. So So when we understand this, we need to know how come he got this particular form. So I'm not going into this story in detail, but it basically goes like this. There was a king named King Indradyumna. He was very interested in worshipping Krishna. And then finally, he understood that there was a deity called this, Jagannath Nilachal, who was being worshipped. He wanted to establish worship of Krishna that way. And then finally, Krishna arranged for him this particular form of Jagannath to be worshipped. And King Indradyumna received a log of wood when he went to take bath in the Ganges. And then these beautiful deities were carved by none other than Vishwakarma, who is believed to be the architect of the heavens. And then this establishment of the deity worship of Jagannath, Baldev and Subhadra took place in the land of Puri. So for thousands and thousands and thousands of years, worship of Jagannath, Baladev and Subhadra has been taking place in Puri. Now, how did these deities from Puri actually manifest in Navadvip Dham? So let's see that story. So once what happened is that there was a Yavana king. So we all know that Yavanas or the Muslim rulers, they took over India in a grand scale, right? So they plundered India and they did not leave the temples. Of course, they were very envious of the temples. So once they wanted to attack the Puri temple itself. So fearing about, their lord being destroyed or, their lord being affected, these people in Puri, the Pandas, the Pujaris, they were so frightened. They were praying to Jagannath for mercy. And at that time, Jagannath came in the Pujari's dreams and he said, "Don't worry, I will never be destroyed. But just to give you all this particular, opportunity to continue and worship me, I'm going to suggest you something. So tomorrow morning, take me away from this temple, take me outside the Puri temple and go ahead the path of the jungle towards Bengal." So this is what Jagannath instructed. So like as Jagannath instructed, next morning, the very lovable Pujaris who were pure devotees, they took Jagannath, Baldev and Subhadra and they started to trek in the jungle, right? So as they were going in the jungle, they faced a lot of difficulties, of course, but with the mercy of Jagannath, they were able to continue their journey. And then in one particular place, it was indicated by Jagannath himself that he wanted to stay there. And that was in Bengal, and very much it is the place in Navadvip Dham. So the people who were actually carrying Jagannath, so there are different castes of people who are worshipping Jagannath. So so those people who carry Jagannath are called as the Sabras. So they were the one who were carrying Jagannath. So when they were carrying, Jagannath gave them this instruction to stop at a particular place and then start worshipping. So even today in Navadvip Dham, there is a place called Sabaradanga, which is very much close to the site of the Rajapur, present day Rajapur Jagannath temple, and thereby the establishment of worship of the same Puri Jagannath actually started here in West Bengal. After that, somehow the temple was not really taken care well of, and then the deities disappeared, right? So this is how they actually manifested here in Sri Mayapur. So that Yavana's king, king's name, by the way, was Raftabahu. Information that you may want to remember. So this happened in the 7th century AD, right? The 7th century it happened, 700, right? So then we're talking about the next century, like many centuries later, not next century, many centuries later, which is the 16th century, right? 1600s. What happened? So 1600s was the time when Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was here. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was very much there in Puri again, worshipping Jagannath in so much of ecstasy. And devotees from Bengal, they would always be so eager to go and see Lord Chaitanya. So every year, these devotees, of course, to see Lord Jagannath also. So these devotees from Bengal, they would go all the way from Bengal walking up to Puri, and then they would go and offer their respects and worship to Jagannath. And they would not be there for just one or two days, but they would be there almost for 4 months together in the association of their loving company of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So you can understand the ecstasy these devotees must be undergoing, right? So much of Jagannath, so much of Jagannath Prasadam, so much of Mahaprabhu. So this must have been like a total out of the world situation. So there was this one really nice devotee called Jagadish Ganguly, right? So he was also from Bengal, and it was it was a part of his ritual every year where he would go and see Jagannath. And unfortunately, as he became old, he became, you know, blind, and he was taken over by disease, so he could no more travel to Jagannath Puri. So he was so upset, he was so dispotent. You can understand the feeling that he is not able to see Jagannath, the Lord of his life. He's not able to associate with all the devotees, and nobody agrees to take him also because they're scared that, you know, he may die or something on the way. So because he's weeping every night, then one fine day Jagannath comes in his dreams, and then he tells him, don't worry, I want to re-establish myself here in Navadvip Dham. So I will appear to you as a log of wood when you go and take bath in the Ganges. Take the log of wood and go give it to a leper carpenter here in Rajapur, and he will carve me out. So taking this dream very seriously, this devotee, he went in search of, he went to the Ganges and he took his bath. And sure enough, there was a log of wood that came and struck him. And he was so jubilant, he took this log of wood and he went in search of this leper carpenter. Obviously, the leper carpenter, he felt very humbled and he felt that he could not do this service. He felt very unqualified. He had pus oozing from his hands, and he had deformed hands. So he was fingers. So he was telling this Jagdish Ganguly that, how do you think I can ever be qualified to carve Jagannath? And even if I start carving, I won't be able to finish because I'm so deformed. But then Jagdish Ganguly is very, very particular about the fact that he has to carve because Jagannath has instructed him to do so. And he implores him to do the service. And finally, the leper carpenter agrees. And after he agrees, he starts carving. While he's carving, he has so much of blood, so much of pain. He's undergoing so much of austerity while carving Jagannath. But he continues with determination. That's a very good quality of regulative principle of bhakti, which he took up. So he was continuing with a lot of determination, with a lot of enthusiasm. And then he could finally carve Jagannath. And then as soon as he finished carving the same Rajapur Jagannath in front of us, I hope you're able to see my screen, his leprosy disappeared. So that is the mercy of the Lord, right? So Rajapur Jagannath is extremely merciful. So this leper's leprosy disappeared, and then again Jagannath came back to Jagdish Ganguly's dream, and he told him that now you go and find neem wood and you can carve me. You can carve Baladev and my sister Subhadra. So finally, the same carpenter, he then carved Jagannath, Baladev and Subhadra. So these are the same deities, same wooden deities that were carved more than 500 years ago that are still being worshipped in Rajapur Jagannath. So perhaps we can say that Rajapur Jagannath deities are the oldest Jagannath deities in the entire world. Because even in Puri, once in every 12 years or something, they did change Jagannath. Of course, Dharu Brahman, he remains the same, but they change Jagannath. The wood is changed. They make new deities. But Rajapur Jagannath deities are extremely amazing because they have not even been changed for the last 500 years or even more. Right? So this happened in the 16th century AD. Now, Jagannath's pujari was this Ganguly, right? So Jagdish Ganguly. But unfortunately, after him, his relatives, they were not taking care of Jagannath properly. One lady in the house, she even, disregarded Jagannath. So Jagannath immediately said that if you all worship me anymore, I'm going to kill everybody in this particular village. And that night, Jagannath had communicated this in a dream. And to the actual surprise, the next morning, everybody in Ganguly's family had died. So the entire village ran away from there and the whole village was deserted. And no more were Jagannath, Baladev and Subhadra worshipped. So the Lord, why he appears, why he disappears, why he chooses to manifest, why he doesn't choose to manifest is totally up to him because the Lord is absolutely independent. But if we understand the transcendental glories of the Lord, then we have a chance to definitely go back to Godhead. Krishna says this in the Bhagavad Gita, right? So when we are trying to understand the transcendental activities of the Lord, then we have the chance of entering the kingdom into his God. So this katha is definitely an attempt for us to take the transcendental activities of the Lord seriously, meditate on him, connect on him, and thereby enter into the spiritual world. Right. So then what happened is that after many, many years, that is, so I was speaking about the 16th century AD, so a few years into the 16th century, Jagannath was worshipped. After that, for hundreds and hundreds of years, until we reach the 19th century. Now, in 100 years, so many things can happen. The world can drastically change. The world that you and me have seen 20 years ago itself is very, very different from the world we see now. So we're talking about hundreds of years. We're talking about main deities, and we'll see how they have survived. So in the year 1958, right? So in many centuries later, people started hearing. So this particular land where Jagannath was not touched by people. Like I explained, you know, people ran away from that place because they'd started dying. And after that, this entire place was snake infested, right? So it was fully snake infested. People would not go there. And then they started hearing voices. So Jagannath, the beautiful Jagannath, he was calling out saying that, you know, I'm thirsty, give me water. But then most of the people around here were Muslims, and they were only scared. I mean, they were not able to understand why these voices came and why the snake-filled places. So they neglected it. So there was this fortunate person. Now, his name was Jaimini Ghosh. So Jaimini Ghosh was from the nearby village of Bahadrapur. So it was very close to Rajapur. And he was passing by the path of the Rajapur Jagannath temple. And while he was passing by, it was a little in the night. So what happened is that there was a storm, and a big bamboo tree crashed in front of him. Now imagine you're alone, you're at night, it's dark, and there's a bamboo tree that falls in front of you. I'm sure we would be in a very uncomfortable position. So similarly, this Jaimini Ghosh, he was very scared. And then he thought that perhaps this is some influence of a ghost. So he was thinking that it's an influence of a ghost, and he just lay down there with hands and legs struck in fear. So then he realized that, oh my God, I mean, I don't know what I'm going to do. If I'm going to move, then this ghost is going to hurt me. And then he hears a voice that the voice is saying that actually it's me, it's Jagannath. I'm here in this place that is right next to you, and I'm thirsty and I want to be worshipped. So please help me. So then Jaimini Ghosh has his own doubts. And then he's thinking that, okay, fine. If you're really Jagannath, then take me home. You know, I want to go home safely. As if he was actually lifted by the wind, like he was just carried away with absolutely no effort of having to walk. He reached his home. He even crossed the Ganges. It is described that he crossed even without a boat, and he reached his home. So this Jaimini Ghosh, he went and informed this to the owner of the land. So the owner of the land, his name was Fatik Chatterjee. I'm not Fatik Chatterjee, if I'm pronouncing him rightly. So this Mr. Chatterjee, again, this amazing Brahmana, so he was a family man, and he owned land in Rajapur. He was not staying in this area. And then he realized that it was the Lord's call for him to worship him. So very faithfully, he moved himself and his entire family to Rajapur. With great difficulty, he constructed a temple. This temple is still there, like near the Shivalinga, for those of you who have visited the Rajapur temple. There's a Shivalinga in Rajapur temple, and just close to that, there's a small building that's almost, you know, not so well, pretty dilapidated now. That particular place is where the temple was constructed in the year 1958, and the worship of Jagannath started again. So we can see how the Lord is manifesting himself again and again. And after 1958 of manifestation, the beautiful Lord is still available for giving his darshan here, right? So, and then the worship continued. He tried and worshipped Jagannath with all his might, with whatever money he had. Very sincerely, this Chatterjee, he carried on the worship of Lord Jagannath. And then what happened is that in the year about 1979, this Pujari, he felt, you know, he was not healthy anymore. He was not happy, you know, in the way he was worshipping Jagannath. His body wouldn't allow him. And then finally, he took the amazing decision of giving these deities to ISKCON, right? So these deities were legally, officially handed to ISKCON, and His Holiness Jayapatak Maharaj, who was then and even now the managing head of ISKCON Mayapur, he very happily took up the worship of Jagannath, Baldev and Subhadra. And like you know, Prabhupada has set such wonderful standards for deity worship in ISKCON that they constructed a beautiful temple with funds from devotees, and Jagannath, Baldev and Subhadra's worship takes place very, very meticulously till today. So yes, we see how active Jagannath has been from the time he's been wanting to establish himself. First of all, he came from Puri, and he proves himself that Navadvip has all the kshetras and it has Jagannath Puri here. And then he's been worshipped by one particular devotee, Ganguly, even during the time of Mahaprabhu. After Mahaprabhu, this temple was established. And after that, we saw of how they continued worship of Jagannath, Baldev and Subhadra. So these are such active deities, and their activity, their interaction, their loving relationships with their devotees just didn't stop then, right? So it always continued. So their activities are going on until today. So even if you come today to Rajapur Jagannath, and I'm sure each of you will have your own experiences with Rajapur Jagannath, because that's how much he's waiting for having interactions with his devotees. So first, I would like to narrate some pastimes that took place between the 1950s and 1970s. That is, this is the time before ISKCON took up the worship of Rajapur Jagannath. So what happened is that, like I said, from 1958 onwards, this Fatik Chatterjee, he was worshipping Jagannath. But then towards the end, maybe like in the early 1970s, there was this lot of commotion in Bengal because of Bangladesh. There was a war that was happening, and Hindus did not feel so safe in this particular part, especially where there were a lot of Muslims. Even today, Rajapur is predominantly a Muslim village. There are Muslims living all around Jagannath, but they respect Jagannath to a great deal that you will see why later. So this Fatik Chatterjee, he was a little, you know, he was scared because he had 5 daughters. He didn't feel safe in the community. I mean, we have not undergone situations of war, but you can understand the distress that he was probably going through. And he wanted to leave that particular area, and he actually left. So because he left, again, you know, Jagannath started his same way of interacting with people. He said, I want water, I'm thirsty, nobody's feeding me, why is nobody feeding me? So when the local Muslims heard this, they were again scared. So somehow, I don't know, it seems that Muslims, they get scared when Jagannath is trying to interact with them. They realize that, oh my God, this is a really powerful personality, deity here. So then what happened is that they went and they called for this Fatik Chatterjee, and they said that you please come back. I know you're feeling, you know, you are feeling a little scared to be around us, etc. But we will ensure that we will give you complete protection. So Lord Jagannath, he gives complete protection to his devotees. So even though some material situation may seem so adverse, Jagannath actually makes it a point to make that adversity also, even in that adversity, a devotee always remains very safe and sound. And thereby Fatik Chatterjee could continue his worship. So there's another situation similarly. So Fatik Chatterjee, he was a person who gave up most of his material life. He was living in another town. So obviously he had a business. He had so many things going on. But just for the sake of Jagannath, he moved. And we will see how this particular family was so absolutely protected by Jagannath. So one day it was his daughter's wedding. And this area, Mayapur, Rajapur, it was very, very famous for the dacoits, the Naxalites, right? So they would always plunder people and cause so much difficulty in people's life. So it was Chatterjee's daughter's wedding, and very nicely arranged wedding. And then they have these dacoits entering, and everybody gets so upset. And, you know, it's so much of anxiousness, and Chatterjee is so anxious that, oh my God, my daughter's getting married and these dacoits are here. And then somehow the wedding happens properly. The dacoits who came there, they start fighting amongst each other and they go away. A few days after the wedding took place, the head of the dacoits, he actually came to visit this Chatterjee. And then he was knocking on the door that, you know, Chatterjee, open the door, I want to speak to you. So if you have a dacoit outside your house, I'm sure you won't open your open the door. So similarly, Fatika Chatterjee said, I'm not opening my door now. I don't want you to enter my house. Please don't trouble me. So he said, no, no, I'm not come to trouble you, but I want to tell you something. I want to tell you that your Lord is actually protecting you, that your Lord is actually completely sheltering you. So then he said that we are a group of dacoits, like, you know, we came to plunder your wedding. We came to spoil the wedding. We came to take away all the gold in the wedding. But then I could see a particular light, you know, there was this effulgence around you and your daughter that was coming. And I thought this was Jagannath's. This was Jagannath who was giving this light and, you know, who was giving us this this indication that they are protected by my divine energy. So I told the people under me that, you know, we should go back and we should not plunder these people. They somehow didn't listen to me. But then later they had such a big argument amongst themselves that they automatically left the place and go. So we see how the Lord is continuously protecting them. So one is they became scared, they ran away, the Lord brought them back. And after bringing them back also, the Lord ensured that they remained very comfortable. And the Lord actually protected even the wedding, right? So he was personally there taking care of this family. Another incident where he took care of this wonderful family. So Fatik Chatterjee's wife, Nirmala Devi, she was really sick on one of the Snanayatra days. Now, Snanayatra is a festival that happens where they bathe Jagannath, right? So that's again a very pompous festival that takes place even till today here in Rajapur. Thousands and thousands of villagers, they don't even know where these villagers come from. All these people come on this particular day to bathe Jagannath, Baldev and Subhadra, the oldest and the most amazing deities. Okay, so coming back to this one fine day of Snanayatra that was taking place, Fatik Babu's wife, Nirmala Devi, what happened to her? She had a very bad fever. She was very sick and she could not participate in the Snanayatra ceremony. She was feeling so bad. I mean, we understand when we have to go to a festival and we're not doing well, how we should be feeling. So she was so upset and lying down on bed. And everybody else at home had gone to the festival and they came back and then her situation was deteriorating. And then this Fatik Chatterjee, he saw something really unusual in his house. He saw a footprint, right? He saw a footprint that was quite huge, that was quite unusual. And he did not understand where this footprint came in because nobody was there at home. So anyway, so he was wondering where this footprint came. And then he also realized that there's a lot of dust in that footprint. So what he does is that he takes a little of the dust and he puts it on his wife, Nirmala Devi's forehead. And to his surprise, she's absolutely cured. Then he realizes that this is actually Jagannath's making. This is actually Jagannath's footprint. And Jagannath had provided his own footprint, foot dust, so that Nirmala Devi gets protected. So we are seeing repeatedly that how Jagannath is the protector of the devotee. So he is not only the Lord of the universe as Jagannath, but he is protecting us. So if we take shelter of Rajapur Jagannath, we will surely be protected in our process of devotional service. Where else can we find a deity who is so reciprocative, right? And then, so like this, there are so many pastimes that have been described. Another pastime is that not only is he protecting this family, he's also protecting the entire village because the entire village is also quite respectful towards Jagannath. So there was an epidemic like now. There was an epidemic that was going about in that particular area. People were dying. There were no medicines available and there was chaos all over. So then Jagannath came in the dream of the pujari, Fatik Chatterjee, and he told him that there is a particular medicine and if that medicine is made, then everybody will be cured. And that medicine needed many herbs. So they went in search of these herbs and they found all the herbs except one. So they were wondering how to find this one herb alone. And then surprisingly, there was a little boy who they had never seen in the village before that particular day. Like, imagine, you know, the situation is so intense. People are dying. There's an epidemic and, you know, you don't know. Hundreds and hundreds of people are dying. And then finally, Jagannath comes in the dream and he tells you to make a medicine. You're making a medicine and then you realize you don't have an ingredient, right? And then it's a tough situation. But then when they see a little boy coming with this particular herb, right? He was selling this particular herb. They were so excited. They bought the herb and they immediately, they made the medicine. So they made the medicine and sure enough, they distributed to everybody in the village and everybody got cured. So again, we see here Jagannath is not only protecting the devotees, but he's also protecting everybody around in that area who has even little faith in him. Interestingly, I heard recently that the Pandas in Jagannath Puri, I don't know if it is true, recently that during this corona episode that they had Jagannath coming in their dream and Jagannath told them that anybody who has my Mahaprasad and Tulsi offered to me, they will definitely not be affected with corona. So there were a lot of devotees in Mayapur who were taking Jagannath's Prasad and Jagannath's Puri, Jagannath's Prasad and Tulsi, saying that, you know, with full faith that they will not be affected by corona. So there are many, many pastimes that happened even before ISKCON took over. We are still in between the 1950s to 1970s. So Jagannath is very merciful. He sure protects his deities, but he also teaches lessons very quickly, especially Rajapur Jagannath. He is so not slow in teaching us lessons, right? So there was a little girl and she was a Muslim girl and she was playing in with her friends in the campus of Rajapur temple. And she actually sat down showing her feet to the deities, right? So showing the feet to the deities is definitely not something that's appreciated. We would never do that, I'm sure. So so what happened is that when her friends told her that this is Jagannath, you better be careful. Don't show your legs and immediately apologize. But then she was very frivolous about it. She didn't take it seriously. And she said, he's not my God anyway. And then she didn't care a damn about it. And she faced the music. It so happened that what happened is that within a very short time, her feet actually became infected. And not only was it infected then, but throughout her life, she continued to limp because she lost a part of her foot. Now that's what happens when we disregard Jagannath, when we disregard Baladev. Just recently, yesterday, I was hearing also a pastime where similarly, Prabhupada in the US when he was there and in one particular temple, I think in the Matchless gift shop, he was there and there were devotees who already started worshipping the deities there. And when Prabhupada entered, they all offered obeisances. Some of them, in this act of their enthusiasm, they showed their legs to the deities. Prabhupada immediately took his cane and he actually beat one of the devotees, Brahmananda Prabhu. You know, he beat him on his leg and he said, do not offer obeisances while showing your feet to the deities. So I think that's something that we have to remember. Even Prabhupada was very quick to punish or to remind devotees of how dangerous an act that could be. And what is the time? It's 11:35. Okay. So we are still in the pastimes from 1950s to the 1970s. So once what happens, this is a very, very popular pastime of Jagannath that everybody knows. Right? So about 25 years ago, there was Snan Yatra festival again. And there was a rickshawala who brought his Muslim rickshawala friend inside the temple. And the pujari offered him khichdi prasad. So khichdi prasad, and it was very tasty, very delicious for everybody else. Unfortunately, this Muslim pujari, he could not understand the importance. Not pujari, this Muslim riksha wala, he could not understand the importance. He disregarded, Jagannath's prasad. And the pujari was saying, why did you come here? Why do you come inside here and offend Jagannath and go? And he said, I don't care about this prasadam, etc. And then that night, he had a very, very tough time because Baladev came and caught him, right? Literally sat on top of him and started beating him and choking him and killing him. And Subhadra was so excited and very angry. And she said, you know, you should kill him. You should kill him because he disregarded my Jagannath's prasad. And then both Baladev and Subhadra would have almost killed him. And Jagannath finally, you know, he says, it's okay, let him go. And then finally, he lets go of him. So this, I mean, you can imagine this person, this rikshawala, he's had a dream. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Balaram, I mean, his expansion, Balaram, is sitting on him and banging him. You can imagine the feeling. When you get a nightmare in the night, you know how difficult it is. And here, the Lord itself is coming and bashing you up. So he's so frightened. He runs to the temple the next morning and he begs for prasadam. And then the pujari is like, excuse me, have you gone mad? Yesterday you said no to prasadam and today you want prasadam. And he narrates whatever happens and then he apologizes and he takes prasadam. So this is again another lesson that Mahaprasadam is never ever disrespected. And especially Jagannath prasadam, Rajapur Jagannath prasadam, Puri Jagannath prasadam, we better be very careful and never ever neglect his prasadam. And we can see, you know, how eager Lord Jagannath is here to actually show his presence to us. And he's so eager to give his mercy. Again, this is because he's in Lord Chaitanya's place. He is more merciful. He's most merciful. So even Narasimhadev, I was explaining, if you all remember, that because he is here in Navadvip, he's in the mood of Gauranga Mahaprabhu. He wants to give. He wants to show. He wants to protect his devotees. Similarly, Jagannath here is in that mood. So the Lord can't get more merciful. Okay, so I think I don't have much time. So here we come finally when the deities have been handed over to ISKCON and ISKCON has started the worship. So what better way to worship the Lord than worship him in Srila Prabhupada's own premises? And under the direction of amazing pujaris like Jananivas Prabhu and Pankajangri Prabhu. So actually all these leelas which I am now describing is from a book written by His Grace Pankajangri Das. In case you all don't know, then he is one of the head pujaris of ISKCON Mayapur and ISKCON internationally. They are the ones who set the standards for deity worship in ISKCON by following what Srila Prabhupada has given them. So then we see that yes, the deities have finally reached ISKCON. So one of the first pastimes that took place was that His Holiness Jayaprathak Maharaj, so when he established the temple and he was trying to, you know, legally sort out things and get the land, etc., it so happened that they did not get the entire land under the acquisition. Maharaj was very particular that until they get everything completely under ISKCON's name, they should not start Jagannath's worship. But the pujari had already started Jagannath's worship and they started, you know, offering to Jagannath. Now, Maharaj didn't know about this. So then the pujari, he had a dream in the night and, you know, with Jagannath, Baldev and Subhadra, they're walking out of the temple. And then this pujari is like, you know, where are you going, Jagannath, Baldev, Subhadra, where are you going? He's like literally running after them and they're walking away in the fields, right? And then Jagannath, Baldev and Subhadra, they turn to him and say, you're not feeding us prasadam. We heard that in Mayapur and Rajapur are a few miles away, right? So we are going to Mayapur because in Mayapur, Radha Madhav is being served very nice prasadam. And you're not serving prasadam here, so we are going. So then this pujari realizes his mistake. He goes running to Jayaprathak Maharaj and Jayaprathak Maharaj says, oh my God, we've started offering Jagannath, Baldev, Subhadra food and you stopped that. So that's really bad. So that's one of the first pastimes that ISKCON experienced. And they started serving very opulent prasadam. And not only did they serve opulent prasadam, they actually started serving chappan bhog. And the chappan bhog is what is offered to Lord Jagannath. Interestingly, they called pandas from the Puri temple and they got, Janivas Prabhu got all these particular pujaris in our ISKCON temple trained up to make different varieties of prasadam. So especially Rajapur Jagannath prasadam in Mayapur is very, very famous. So devotees like wait and try and book plates of Mahaprasadam. So how even this Mahaprasadam service went on? So the Lord arranges everything for himself. So once Janivas Prabhu decided that we are going to offer, you know, as many items as possible. And of course, the temple did not have so much money. So he went and prayed in front of Jagannath that, my dear Jagannath, for 1 month, we are going to offer you chappan bhog. So after this, if you want to really eat so many items, then you arrange it yourself. So 1 month had passed by. Janivas Prabhu was just casually mentioning this to another devotee who visited Mayapur, and then that devotee immediately agreed to sponsor Bhoga for Jagannath for the next few months. And like this, it continued, and even till today, there are people who are called as Nitya Sevaks who continuously go ahead and supply Bhoga for Jagannath so that he is fed sumptuously. So if we have the desire to, you know, serve Jagannath, he automatically arranges. So we saw how he wonderfully protects the devotees. He takes care of our material needs. He takes care of our bodily needs. Like even if you get sick, he was there for his devotees. And then we see that especially for service, he is showing them that he is absolutely alive and eating every morsel of prasadam by appearing in the pujari's dream. And then he also arranges this exuberant variety of prasadam which can be distributed to everybody. So then again, like we said, so ISKCON has recently started worship. So at that time, they did not, you know, build this entire facility that was available now. So they did not have a kitchen, obviously. So they would bring prasadam, they would bring bhoga to be offered to Jagannath from the Radha Madhav temple. So the pujari would cycle all the way. It's not a great deal of a distance, but it is definitely at least a 15-minute cycle or a 20-minute cycle away. So this pujari, he every day, this was his duty, he would bring the cooked food from Mayapur Chandrodaya Mandir back to Rajapur. So when he was doing that, one day what happened is that he realized he didn't have tulsi. And there was no tulsi growing around that area. And sure enough, the place is infested with Muslims. They don't grow tulsi either. And he was very upset. Now he prayed to Jagannath that, my dear Jagannath, I know you don't accept anything without tulsi, but I don't have tulsi today. And if I go looking around for tulsi, it's going to become late for your prasadam. So please forgive me, forgive my offense, and please, please, please accept this bhoga. So then he prays like this and he closes the door. Sure enough, after he opens the altar, after the time is over for offering, he goes and he sees a really long tulsi manjari and tulsi leaves. You know, the Lord had arranged this tulsi just for himself, and the devotee, the pujari, he was so absolutely overwhelmed. So it's 11:45 here. I'll stop now. And these are the, you know, wonderful day pastimes of Rajapur Jagannath, Baldev and Subhadra. I hope the Lord is pleased with us for hearing about him, and I hope he bestows us with his mercy and his pure devotional service. Matri, I'm not sure. Mataji, Sukriti Mataji, I don't know if she's here. Maybe I'll just tell one more pastime before Mataji ends the session. I don't know if she has sent anything in the chat. Okay, I don't know, she's not here yet. So the one pastime of a Muslim girl. So not only the devotees, even Muslims, the local Muslims were experiencing Jagannath here, right? So there was this little girl who was losing her eyesight, and there were no proper doctors available. And even now there are, you know, it's not like a great healthcare system present here, so they had to go to Calcutta, and in Calcutta they said that she's not going to regain her eyesight, and there's not much hope. I'm sure, you know, if you don't have eyesight, it is a huge problem. It's going to affect your entire life. We perhaps cannot even imagine how life would be without our eyes. She was worried, and her family was very worried. So finally they heard about the glories of Rajapur Jagannath, and they were staying close by, so they thought, yes, he's a Hindu god, but why not take a shelter? So they went and prayed to Jagannath. They went and prayed to Baladev. They went and prayed to Subhadra, requesting for eyesight. And as advised by the pujari, they took Charnamrita for 7 days. The girl continuously took Charnamrita, and she gained eyesight. So even the local Muslims like the rickshawala initially, and this Muslim girl and many other Muslims, they have so much of faith in Jagannath because he's not just protecting his devotees, but he's protecting anybody and everybody who has a little faith in him. So all he's asking for is faith. Mataji? I'll just message.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Auntie. Yes,
Hare Krishna.
Yes.
Yes, Nandapriya.
So we're done, Mataji.
So how many of you felt that you were actually transferred to the land of Lord Jagannath? Please type in your chat boxes, me. Type me in your chat boxes. Three, four, five, six, seven. Wow. So Nandapriya, thank you so much for taking so many devotees to Mayapur just by your session.
Thanks.
So as we told before also, Nandapriya is actually located in Mayapur. She is so fortunate that she visits these wonderful temples very often, almost daily. And Jagannath temple is a little away from our Mayapur main temple. So I don't know if during this time if she is visiting there or not, but otherwise, like, hoping and praying that all of us together someday soon we can visit this wonderful place. So thank you, Nanda. Also, those of you who have not attended yesterday's Chaitanya Charitamrita class, who are not attending the CC class, in the chat window I have shared a link. This link is for a form. I request all of you to please click on this link and please submit the details. This would be really helpful for us in assessing your needs and our service areas. We will get to know how it can be improved. So I humbly request all of you, those who have not filled the form yesterday, because we circulated this form yesterday also. So those of you who have not filled yesterday, kindly click at the link and please submit the form. So we will stop here. And looking forward to see all of you today evening for a Sunday special session, evening 6:30. So thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
So much, Nandapriya.
Thank you, Mataji.
Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Mataji. Thanks, Akka.